central coast of California. If you could end 60% of drunk driving or child abuse, would you? It's a no-brainer, right? So why isn't everyone in favor of banning pit bulls responsible for 60% of death by dog? Welcome to Mr. Mom. My name is David Marine. Today's show is live on the radio station site, KSCO.com, so you can listen online or with your smartphone. We're also on Facebook, Mr. Mom Radio, and of course we're on Twitter, at Mr. Mom Radio. Spell out Mr. All past shows can be heard on my website, MrMomRadio.com. We've had shows on how kids learn, adoption reform, sibling rivalry, school safety. My guest today, talking to me and us about dogs and pit bulls, joining me in the studio is Todd Stosi. He's the president of the National Animal Control Association. Todd is also the field services manager for the Santa Cruz County Animal Shelter. He's had an interesting life. He has two bachelor's degrees from Rutgers University, one in criminal justice, the second in sociology. He's worked as an EMT and as a first grade teacher in urban Philadelphia. He worked for the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, the PETA group, before moving to California. He has two dogs and four cats. Todd, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Glad to be here.
Our pleasure. And you, our listeners, are welcome to call or email your pit bull thoughts, 831-479-1080, or email david@mrmomradio.com. We've already had comments on Facebook about the show and Twitter and emails. And a vet office actually in Hollister questioning my 60% figure. And we have a spirited, let's say, email from a California Pit Bull Rescue Group in Oakland, and we will get to those shortly. People find out about the show because of Facebook, Twitter, promotions that we run on the station. So Todd and I will be joined later by attorney Kenneth Phillips. He's the dog bite king of the legal universe, according to the Today Show. And before we begin, just so people know, I've had a variety of dogs, mostly mutts. I bought an expensive blue Doberman when I was in college, broke, had no business buying that dog. Now, my kids and I have a Craigslist mix we bought for $80 last year. She was actually advertised as a pit lab mix, but I could see in the photos online that there was little or no pit in the mix. She's little with brown and black stripes, so we call her Tigger. She loves to play, and she loves to chew on photo albums. So, Todd, before we get to pit bulls, tell us about the National Animal Control Association and how you became involved.
Sure. The National Animal Control Association, am I getting feedback there?
So the National Animal Control Association, we actually recently changed our name to the National Animal Care and Control Association. It's an organization, it's a nonprofit that's been around since 1978 to increase the professionalism as well as the training standards for animal control officers across the United States. We currently have around 4,000 members in our group. Every single state is represented. We also have some officers up in Canada, and we train all around the country to certify animal control officers in proper techniques and laws and, you know, making sure that they're out there doing the job that needs to be done.
Okay. And so you also work in animal control in Santa Cruz, and, you know, I got to tell you, it sounds like you have a cool job. You go to the beach, then you have some excitement, and then you go back to the beach. Is that a good summary of what you do?
No, not really. We basically, at the Santa Cruz County Animal Shelter, the field services division is responsible for responding to all animal complaints within the county of Santa Cruz, city of Santa Cruz, city of Watsonville, and the city of Scotts Valley. We currently only have three officers plus myself, and we work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, so we're stretched very far, and you know, we have a lot of work to do and very few people. You know, so we handle anything from animal neglect complaints to cockfighting, dogfighting, vicious animal complaints, dog bites, loose livestock. So it runs the gamut. But we occasionally do get to walk the beach and hand out leash tickets. So yes, there's some.
Oh, really?
There's some of that. Yeah, there's some of that beach going on.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay. So, you know, we mentioned before the show started, we were chatting a little bit, that you really enjoy your work, and it looks to me like it really is a lot of fun. I've been to a few shelters in the last several years looking at dogs. My daughter wanted to volunteer at one. So I've been to shelters in southern Santa Clara County, in Monterey, and invariably they're pretty much packed with pit bulls and chihuahuas. Why is that?
Well, the pit bull breed is actually not even a breed. It's the American Staffordshire is the actual breed that a lot of people refer to, you know, with pit bulls. But they definitely had a rise in popularity years back, and that we're continuing to see that trend. And without aggressive spay-neuter ordinances or aggressive spay-neuter capabilities in certain communities, those animals are going to continuously breed, and they're going to fill up the shelters. Same with chihuahuas. They're just a dime a dozen. You know, people want them. They're not getting them spayed and neutered, so they're breeding, and so it's just increasing the capacity in the shelters.
Right. You know, my chihuahua theory is that people don't understand when chihuahuas are mature enough to do the excitement, as they say, so they get surprised, right? So we can't really talk about pit bulls and dogs like pit bulls without talking about the people who own them. So let's say that you've been called out to a home and there's a snarling dog in the yard, pit bull or any dog, and there's an owner standing on the porch. Which visual gives you more information? Can you figure out by looking at the owner what the situation is going to be? The dog, both?
The dog is easiest. Dog body language, as soon as you understand how to read a dog, you will never make a mistake. Dogs give very firm visual cues about what their intentions are, and as soon as you understand how to read that, it's a piece of cake. Humans, on the other hand, can hide their intentions. They can lie to you, and they, you know, can do all sorts of things underhanded, and they're much harder to read, much harder to deal with.
You know, you talk about dog body language, and last summer I had Victoria Stilwell on the show. She hosted the Animal Planet show, It's Me or the Dog, and we actually, the show was about best family pets. It was going to be a pretty harmless show, but we ended up talking about pit bulls because of the death that had just occurred here in the Bay Area. But she made an observation, you talk about dog body language, that I thought was very interesting, because she said that one of the ways that dogs communicate is with their tail. And with some pit bulls, for sure, with Dobermans, and I had a Doberman and I docked his tail, Rottweilers, Boxers, people who are friendly to these breeds are in fact putting them and the people around them in danger by taking away one of the ways that they communicate. What do you think about that?
Well, a wagging tail isn't always just a sign of happiness. It, you know, tails can wag really quickly if a dog's showing signs of aggression as well. So the tail is not specifically something you're going to be looking at when you're approaching an animal and trying to determine its whether it's aggressive or not. You're more looking at the posturing of its face and the posturing of its body as opposed to the tail.
Okay, all right. So I found a study, and I'm going to refer to a few studies today, and they're all posted on the MrMomRadio.com website, so people can see where the studies are sourced from. And it analyzed the impact on hospital emergency rooms, and it showed that dog bites had increased almost 100% from 1993 to 2008, and now nationally, there are about 1,000 dog bites a day. So what do you attribute that increase to?
And I mean, the dogs have definitely raised, they've gained popularity on the animal totem pole, so to speak. People are definitely much more into dogs and cats than they were back in 1993. Dogs are moving inside the house. They're no longer being kept outdoors. People are really beginning to keep dogs and cats as if they're part of the family. You know, they're buying clothes for them. They're spending thousands of dollars on vet care. And so dogs are just ending up in the household. And what a lot of people don't realize is dogs are animals. They're not little fur babies. They're not little fur children.
Right.
They're animals. And, you know, as an example, my dog is 16 years old. I've had him for the past 16 years. He's never bitten anybody, but I still know in the back of my mind that he is an animal. And if a young child's at my house and a young child jumps on his back, you know, my dog's ability to defend himself is going to be to turn around and bite. And so you always have to keep that in the back of your mind, that even if you have the nicest, friendliest dog in the world, their defense mechanism to protect themselves is to bite, is to fear bite, is to, you know, kind of protect themselves. And people need to realize that and remember that when they're bringing dogs and cats into their households, that there's always that potential, whether it's a pit bull, whether it's a chihuahua, whether it's a, you know, any type of dog has that potential.
Right. So, you know, when I found you, I thought, okay, so Todd's, he's an animal control guy, so he's going to be in favor of banning pit bulls, so I'll need to find someone else who's opposed to banning pit bulls, so we're, you know, fair and balanced, as they say. But to my surprise, your organization is actually opposed to banning pit bulls or any breeding, right?
Correct.
Why?
Yeah, there's no large-scale organization out there, no national group. The Humane Society of the United States, the ASPCA out of New York, Best Friends Animal Sanctuary of Utah, the National Animal Care and Control Association. No large-scale organization, even the American Kennel Club, supports breed-specific legislation.
None of them, you mean?
None of them.
Okay.
None of them support it. It's a breed-specific legislation is almost a knee-jerk reaction to some sort of incident that's occurred in a community where the city council or the county board of supervisors has a horrendous situation that occurs in their jurisdiction, and so they immediately think the way to resolve that is to ban that particular breed, and that it just doesn't work. You know, people need to look at the overall situation as to why that dog reacted in the way it did, as opposed to just that specific breed.
And there are actually countries that have banned pit bulls or pit bull type dogs. They're banned in Ireland, they're banned in Scotland, they're banned in England, they're banned in parts of Canada. Germany has a $1,300 tax to own a pit bull. What's happening locally on the Central Coast in terms of smaller communities, bands, that sort of thing? Is there any activity there that we need to know about?
The city of San Francisco actually passed a mandatory spay-neuter law for all pit bulls.
Okay.
So as opposed to outright banning pit bulls, they proposed a spay-neuter ordinance for them. And I don't know the exact year it came into effect, but I do know in reading some stuff online that their intake of pit bulls at the shelters just dramatically decreased. You know, and that's a huge...
That's good.
Yeah, it's great. You know, for any problem that's out there, spay neuter, you know, we can't emphasize the importance of that in assisting in, you know, decreasing populations of certain dogs as opposed to just banning them outright. I know in most of the dog bite cases that have occurred, you know, specifically with pit bulls, have been intact males, you know, and they're more prone to aggression. So if we can get, you know, the spay neuter done, you know, it's going to help alleviate some of that as well.
Right, very good. Okay, we're going to take a quick break. When we get back, we're going to talk about some of the emails that we received about the show. You're listening to Mr. Mom on KSCO. We'll be right back. Okay, we're back. You're listening to Mr. Mom on KSCO. We're talking today about pit bulls, banning pit bulls, the bully breeds, the dogs that people are often afraid of, whether that is accurate or not. My guest is Todd Stosi. He's the president of the National Animal Control Association. Their site is nacanet.org. So nacanet.org. Todd is also the field services manager for the Santa Cruz County Animal Shelter. He has joined me in the studio at KSCO. So I mentioned at the outset that we've had some emails and comments on Twitter and Facebook. So a vet office, I think in Hollister, disputed my saying that 60% of death by dog is from pit bulls. So I want to share where I got those numbers. The 60% comes from a report on a website called dogsbite.org. Not too hard to remember. Dogsbite.org. I put that report on my website so you can see it. And actually it shows that pit bulls were responsible for 78% of fatal deaths last year. And then I have another report, also on the website, is a 20-year study of dog killings and maulings in the U.S. and Canada. And of the 3,887 fatal and disfiguring cases, 61% were pit bulls and pit mixes. So, you know, if you're going to say, well, pit mixes is not the same thing. Well, but then maybe we should consider banning pit mixes too if they're causing that much damage. So one of the questions I have, and even if people can prove that it's only 40% instead of 60, if you could prevent 40% of drunk driving, or if you can prevent 40% of anything else that troubles us, why wouldn't we? Why isn't, Todd, a ban a good idea?
Well, again, you know, the percentages just tell one side of the story. They don't tell everything that's behind it. You know, is that 60% unneutered dogs? Is that 60% dogs that are chained? Dogs that are chained up are more prone to bite. There's actually a California law that was enacted a couple years ago banning tethering
What is tethering?
Tethering is tying a dog to a stationary object. Yeah, okay. Dogs get very distressed when they're tied up to a stationary object, and they're more prone to be upset, and they'll bite as opposed to dogs that have the freedom and ability to move around.
Okay.
You know, so when you take those percentages, you really have to kind of look at the overall picture to try and understand why there's those numbers. And one of the things with pit bulls is they do have much more powerful jaws than other dogs,
right.
In which, you know, if you're bitten by a pit bull or if you're bitten by a chihuahua, there's definitely going to be a difference in the number of stitches you need and what's going on. So there's that to be taken into account as well.
Right. You know, when I was in college, I went to a pit bull dog show. A friend of mine had pit bulls. He loved pit bulls, and he had a really cool pit bull.
Yeah.
Every owner of pit bulls at that dog show had a hammer handle in his back pocket. No hammer, but the handle to squeeze in there in the mouth if they bite to get them, because they are strong. Okay, Ken Phillips is an attorney from Los Angeles, and he's been called the dog bite king of the legal universe by the Today Show. He knows a whole bunch. Thank you very much. Ken, can you hear us?
I can hear you.
Hey, okay, thank you for joining us. Okay, so Ken, I am here with Todd Stosi. He's the president of the National Animal Control Association and also the local field services manager for the Santa Cruz County Animal Shelter. So we're talking about pit bulls and that sort of thing. So I appreciate you calling in and joining us. Your website says that rescue organizations, pet adoption groups, shelters, people doing good deeds, but people who are transferring ownership of a dog can be held liable if these rescue organizations fail to obtain and report important information about a dog's past. So there are, I don't know, dozens, hundreds of organizations like that in the Bay Area. How many don't know that they could be liable for that?
Well, I don't know how many don't know, but just because you don't know doesn't excuse what it is that goes on in some cases, not in all cases, not by any means in all cases, but in some cases what you have is actually covering up where the dog came from and what the dog's history was. And that's the main thing that they can and should be held liable for. The other thing is when they make a representation that a dog is okay without really knowing whether the dog is okay. That happens all the time, and it's bad for, you know, it's bad for all the adoption organizations when that happens.
Are you in favor of a ban on pit bulls or any breed?
I'm in favor of allowing pit bulls to die out for a whole lot of reasons, which I can get into, but there's a whole lot of reasons for it. Basically, the dog is a extremely problematic dog that's causing too much damage. The people that are breeding the dog have no interest at all in breeding a safer, gentler pit bull. I've been against breed-specific laws for years. I mean, I have been. My website, dogbitelaw.com, has had all kinds of reasons on it ever since the 90s for why we shouldn't go that route. But it's become clear now, statistically, that these dogs are getting worse, that the problems are getting worse, that they're causing too much damage, and that nobody's doing anything about it. So what can you do under those circumstances? You got to say, look, you know, enough is enough. They're killing more people, they're maiming more people, and this isn't just, you know, this isn't rumor. This is actual, these are actual statistics and studies that have been done that have established this. So, yeah, I'm in favor of just letting the breed die out.
I think what makes a stronger argument opposed to what you're saying is getting much stronger animal control ordinances to deal with vicious animals. I think there's a lot of cities and towns across the country that don't have very good ordinances in what to do when an animal does bite or an animal does do something to a human or domestic animal. Here in Santa Cruz County, we can deem an animal a vicious animal after just one bite to a human, after one bite to a domestic animal, even just attempting to attack a human or domestic animal, we can deem that animal vicious, which allows us the ability through a court order to keep that animal contained in an appropriate manner, ensure that that animal is spayed or neutered, muzzle that animal when it's off property. And I think those are much more effective means to curbing the problem as opposed to just outright banning a breed. Most animal control agencies I know don't have the manpower or the ability to go around and actually enforce a breed-specific law. So even if one is put on the books, the enforcement of it's going to be nearly impossible.
All right, Ken and Todd, we have a couple of calls. Let's go ahead and take a call from Julie. Julie, can you hear me?
Yes, Juliet.
Okay, Juliet, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Hi, I'm Juliet Piccone. I'm actually an animal law attorney here in Aurora, Colorado, and we are working to repeal our pit bull ban because for the 8 years that it's been in existence, dog bites have not been reduced, and basically what's happened is over 1,000 family pets have been euthanized, and public safety has not been increased in any way, shape, or form. So right now we're looking at looking at the peer-reviewed studies by the American Veterinary Medical Association from 2010 and 2013 that prove that breed-specific legislation does not improve public safety and actually has absolutely nothing to do with the number of people that are bitten or the severity of the bites.
And I think that makes a very valid point as to why breed-specific laws don't work. Denver's a great example of it. I know a couple officers who work up there, and, they've explained just how nearly impossible it is, how it's even difficult to identify what makes a pit bull. Is it American Staffordshire? Is it a boxer? So that's been a big issue as well. And so it's I think, crucial in dealing with the problem to not just do the outright ban, but to look at other ways to, hold owners accountable and hold particular dogs accountable for their behavior.
All right, Julia,
yeah, well, the problem is that you don't have enough resources, do you, in your animal control department to actually be proactive doing any of that. And the other problem is that the people that own these dogs really have no interest in, breeding a gentler dog. They frequently have this dog because they like the power that the dog gives them. I mean, look at the situation with felons. Felons are allowed to have pit bulls, and they commit crimes with pit bulls, including robbery and rape and all these other things. And yet, they're not allowed to have guns, but they're allowed to have pit bulls. When you look at the statistics, the fact is that the amount of damage, including the amount of deaths by these dogs, is going up every year. There's no reason for this. There's plenty of nice dogs out there. A dog should be man's best friend, but a dog that is going to kill your children and your neighbors and all this other stuff, not that all of them do. I'm not saying all of them do. I'm just saying that this particular dog is hard to control, and people that have it are not interested in controlling it, and it's just too much of a danger for everybody else.
I think that's a little bit of a blanket statement to say all pit bull owners are bad owners. I know quite a
few.
Which
is not what I said.
Well, you said these people are not breeding them to make them kinder, gentler. I know a number of people who have spayed and neutered pit bulls who are very, very wonderful dogs. In fact, we call them wiggle butts because they get so excited and they'll wag their whole entire backside as opposed to just their tail. And one point I made earlier prior to you coming on is that people need to realize that dogs, whether they're pit bulls, chihuahuas, chows, anything, dogs are going to bite. Dogs are animals. They're not people. And people need to understand that when you bring a dog into your house, there's always that ability for that animal to bite, whether it's from fear, whether it's from food aggression, and, you know, something could happen, and people need to always take that into account. All right, let's take another call.
Of course, but what you have here is a dog that can inflict massive damage. That's the difference between this dog and other dogs that can bite.
All right, let's take another call. We have John from Pasadena. John, can you hear me?
Yeah, my name is actually Josh.
Okay, sorry about that, Josh. Go ahead. You're on the air.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I just wanted to actually dispute your 60% figure that you keep using.
Okay.
First of all, we need to give context to that, because when we're talking about dog-related fatalities, we're only talking about 30 or so instances. So when you say 60%, I mean, even if that was accurate, which I would dispute, that's still only, what, about 18 of the 30?
Okay.
And if you look at the dog-related fatalities, there's always, 99% of the time, there's circumstances that go along with this, one being loose or roaming dogs, the second being chained or resident yard dogs, and the third being unsupervised children, or a mix thereof of those circumstances. So, I mean, there's millions of pit bulls in the country, and we're literally talking about a handful of fatalities, so there needs to be some context there. And the second point I would want to make would be just the dog identification process. Like the gentleman that is on from the Animal Control Association, the identifying of these dogs is extremely difficult. I mean, his own organization doesn't even offer a course in breed identification. So what makes up a pit bull? Is it 1%? Is it 25%? 50%? Mr. Phillips, the attorney that you have on, and his all-encompassing language is just really problematic. I mean, he's sitting here talking about millions of dogs and millions of people that own the dogs.
Okay.
As if they're all the same. But these are individual situations.
Josh, I appreciate the call. So, Todd, go ahead. You respond first, and then, Ken, you can say something.
Well, I agree with all the caller's points. So.
Okay. Well, let me mention, though, since you asked me about the 60%, and you're saying that's not that many. You're right, it isn't that many. And the number of deaths and maulings over the past 20 years, and it's on my website, so you can see the PDF and see where I got the information, works out to 200 per year. And it's a legitimate question, I think, whether or not we treat this like school shootings, where we moan for a few days but do nothing. And it's a legitimate question that we may be overreacting. Ken, what is your thought about that?
No, we're not overreacting. There have been studies that have been conducted. Look at the study that was done by the trauma doctors in Texas in 2011. They reviewed cases in their hospital of dog attacks, and these are not death cases. These are just dog attacks that came in. And they concluded, on the basis of actually treating the people, that attacks by pit bulls are far worse because the morbidity rate, in other words, the death rate is higher, the hospital charges are higher, the risk of permanent injury and disability is higher. And so it's not like we're talking about just let's say 30 deaths per year. We're talking about a lot of damage across the board. Now, all I do is represent dog bite victims all over the country. So you'd think that I would love pit bulls to be out there. But the problem is that, you know, I'm representing little kids, I'm representing adults, I'm representing the families of people who have been killed by pit bulls. And I'm seeing a problem that's gotten worse. I'm seeing that the dogs are admittedly in many, many, many cases in the hands of the wrong people. But it's just like with guns. I mean, we say we don't want people to have machine guns. Why is that? People should have the right to bear arms. Well, you know, a machine gun is just too darn dangerous. That's the point with the pit bull. It's just too darn dangerous to allow, you know, in everybody's home and to allow on our streets.
All right, Ken, we are going to take a break here for a few minutes. Ken, you're welcome to stick around. We appreciate your thoughts and ideas. You're listening to Mr. Mom on KSCO. We're talking pit bulls. We'll be right back. Okay, we're back. Mr. Mom on KSCO. We're talking about pit bulls. I have one question for you, and then we're going to take a call from Tino of the PeaceLovinPitBulls.org. Okay, so Ken, you're there?
Yeah.
Presa Canarios, okay, good Lord. If you're not familiar with Presa Canarios, listeners, They're like pit bulls on steroids, two or three times bigger. And I'm not kidding when I say the closest thing to a Presa Canario in the animal kingdom is a small grizzly bear. So Ken, last year in California, a couple was arrested because their Presa Canario bit their five-year-old son in the face twice in 12 weeks. Your thoughts on criminalizing owner behavior?
Well, owner behavior is the main problem, most likely. In other words, even if you know, if you've got 100 people with pit bulls, even if these pit bulls have been known to nip at people in the past, the owner can still control the dog. When you have dogs that are repeatedly threatening people, I'd say threatening, not necessarily biting them, but threatening to bite them, and you do nothing about it, that is a serious, serious violation of the rights of the people around you. And this is what the penal laws are for. If you have someone who won't learn from their behavior, you've got to force them to learn. You either got to take away the dog, you got to fine them, put them in jail, or you do all three. So I am in favor of it. I'm not in favor of, you know, throwing people in jail for no reason if they don't know what the problem is. I'm not in favor of automatically throwing anybody in jail, even if the dog is a pit bull. But when you know that you have a dangerous animal, whether it's a pit bull or anything else, and you allow it to encounter people unmuzzled, and it causes damage, that's a crime.
Okay, we're going to take a call from Tino. Tino, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right, I'm sorry, Tino, for making you wait. Thanks for your patience. Go ahead.
That's okay. It's just funny that, you know, even a lawyer from Aurora calls up and gives you stats and gives you facts on how BSL does not reduce dog bites, and still we got this guy who, if I didn't know any better, I would say was a troll. BSL does not reduce dog bites. Spain, Italy, Great Britain, the Netherlands, Toronto, Winnipeg, Denver, Miami, they've all reported that BSL has not reduced dog bites. And, you
that's
know,
not true.
You just had a lawyer tell you that it doesn't reduce dog bites, and all these countries have reported the same thing. What's not true?
They've reported the opposite.
Tino, let Ken answer your question.
Why didn't you have a question? Or your point.
Well, okay. The point that you're making is that everywhere they've had these laws, there's been no change. That's absolute nonsense. The fact of the matter is that what they will say is they will say that dog bites in general have not gone down. And that could be true. But we're not talking about dog bites in general, because there are bites that I'm afraid of, and then there are bites that I'm really scared to see happen. So the bites by the big, muscular dogs, those I'm afraid of, and those are the ones that I want to reduce. So those are the ones that you have to pay attention to, not the overall numbers. Numbers lie.
All right, thank you for that call, Tino. Todd, in the studio, your thoughts about the effectiveness of bans?
Again, as I mentioned, I don't think straight-out bans are effective, but I think there's a number of things that need to be taken into consideration. High-quality, low-cost spay neuter is a great one. I mean, that's something that really needs to be taken care of. And just to throw out there for anyone who's in Santa Cruz County, the Santa Cruz County Animal Shelter does offer low-cost spay neuter services through our Planned Pethood program, and you can go on our website at www.scanimalshelter.org for more info on that. But then also, you know, I do agree with some of the points of the lawyer regarding owner behavior and owners not taking responsibility for their actions. If an owner is put on notice and their animal is deemed a vicious animal or they're potentially dangerous or whatever the jurisdiction calls it, and they violate that order, then I believe that the owner should be held accountable as well. It's, you know, they shouldn't just get a slap on the wrist. The dog shouldn't just be taken away and euthanized, because then in the end the dog is the one that's paying the price. You know, the human needs to be held accountable as well, whether that's through jail or monetary fines. But then also, you know, I would say that if there's a vicious dog that does violate its vicious animal order and does end up in a shelter, I'm also for euthanizing that animal just for the animal shelter's liability reasons.
All right, Ken, I have a question for you. There's a concept in law called strict liability. So if somebody owns a lion or somebody works with dynamite, you're automatically liable for anything that happens. Do you see anywhere in the country, Ken, the likelihood of oppressive canarios or pit bulls being analyzed under strict liability?
Well, first of all, in two-thirds of the states, there's strict liability for dog bites. I'm talking strict civil liability, not strict criminal liability.
Okay.
So here in California, it doesn't matter if it's a pit bull or a chihuahua, it bites somebody, you are strictly liable for that to pay all the compensation that's necessary. All right, so now, as for strict criminal liability, if your dog bites somebody, well, you know, I'm not in favor of that. Unless you've had notice that the dog wants to bite people, then, okay, put the person in jail or give them a fine or take their dog away. But until that happens, no, I'm not in favor of strict criminal liability. But strict civil liability, absolutely. Because the question is, who bears the burden of the cost of the damage that was inflicted? Should it be the victim or should it be the person that has the dog and is enjoying the dog, can control the dog, can train and socialize the dog, keep it healthy, keep it free of trauma so it won't bite people? That's the owner, not the victim.
All right, we're going to take a call from Winter in Santa Cruz. Winter, you're on the air.
Hi. I wanted to ask Todd, isn't it possible that pit bulls are the only dogs that can lock their jaw?
Well, yeah, they can lock their jaw, which is often what happens. A lot of bites that occur with pit bulls often are from pit bulls. You know, one thing that's been brought up is that they do have a lot of pit bulls, and I shouldn't say all pit bulls. I hate putting blanket statements out there, but there are small animal aggression issues, and a lot of times the dog will go after another smaller animal, whether it be a dog or a cat, and will latch on to that animal. And it's hard to get that animal's, pit bull, to get them actually to unlock their jaw from that animal that it's attacking.
So, Ken, thank you for that call, Winter. Ken, are you familiar with the pit bull death in the Bay Area last year, the 6-year-old boy? I'm sure you are.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. So, that a lot of people say, you know, it's not the dogs, it's the owners and that sort of thing, and there's a legitimate argument there in many cases, but in this situation, there was a 6-year-old boy playing in the backyard at his uncle's house, and the boy got on the pit bull's back, which is, you know, that's what kids do. The pit bull took the boy off of him by grabbing his head, and the owner of the dog wasn't a gang member. He was a graduate of UC Berkeley and a police officer. So it seems to me like the big issue here is that you have a dog with unusual strength and a dog that is unpredictable. We have that death I mentioned in the San Francisco Bay Area that has people talking now. Are you familiar with that story?
Yes, I am familiar with it, yes.
So it was a 6-year-old boy. He was at his uncle's house and apparently tried to ride the back of the dog, a 2-year-old male pit bull who was not neutered. And the pit bull bit him on the head, held on for a while, and 4 or 5 hours later, the little boy died. What do you think about when you read stories like that?
Well, I read the story, and I saw a lot of the news footage, and I heard a lot of people saying this came out of the blue, and it's a mystery as to why the dog did this, and we can't understand. Not just the family saying that, but officials as well, the police and as well as the lawyers. And there are so many red flags in this story that I'm saying, well, of course, I know why this happened. It's not a mystery. Look, dogs don't do these things out of the blue. It's always a bite like that, especially a fatal bite like that, is always a perfect storm of situation and environment. You've got a 2-year-old unneutered male dog that is an outside dog. That's a load of red flags already. You have a lot of people living in this household. There's another dog there as well that lives out in the yard with this other dog. You've got 8 children playing out in the backyard at the time, and you have one of the children trying to ride the dog. the bite, I'm sure, happened because as the child rode the dog, the dog was either frustrated or angry or fearful, or when the child climbed on the dog's back, maybe it was painful, and the dog turned around and said, no, you're not doing that. Unfortunately, the dog got the child in a place that was very vulnerable, and the child died of the injuries. But the dog didn't grab hold and shake, and it didn't have to be prized off the child. As soon as the adult came, it released. And, you know, that tells me the intention of the bite. The intention of the bite was to say, get lost, but the intention of the bite wasn't to maim and kill. Unfortunately, the bite placement killed this child. And so, you know, again, here we have a pit bull, yes, a breed that's so demonized by the media and by the press, that has killed a child. And why? Because, again, of human ignorance, irresponsibility, recklessness, call it what you will. But it was a preventable bite, like all of these bites. It did not need to happen. And I investigate a lot of these big bites now, and I help police investigate fatalities around the country from dog bites, along with my colleague Jim Crosby, who is a forensic dog bite investigator. So we've done a number of these, and there are so many parallels in these cases that, and unfortunately, they could have been prevented. These children are put in a difficult position, and they are not given the kind of education from their parents or their caregivers, because the parents and the caregivers don't know it either. So it's extremely sad and extremely tragic, but we can prevent these with better education.
One of the things that surprised me most about that story was that the dog was, quote, easily removed from the child by its owner. And the dog wasn't even angry or upset. He just simply turned around and took the kid off his back, I guess, right?
It could have been a startle response, or it could have been the dog just saying, you can't do that. And that's you know, we know if by bite placement or the depth of the bite or we understand, we know about intention. What is the dog's intention? Is the dog's intention to warn? Is it to hurt? Is it to maim? Is it to kill? And I do not believe that bite, because the dog released so easily, was a bite that was intended to kill this child. I think it was a bite that was intended to say, just get lost. But unfortunately, it was in a very vulnerable area.
Right. And I believe the boy was even conscious after the attack and died some days later, and of course the dog was put to sleep the next day.
So, Ken, you first, your comments on that.
Well, that's really the problem. The dog is unpredictable. The dog, for some reason, this dog will suddenly turn on people. You'd think, why would it turn on a little child? Why would it drag a child through the window? Why would it drag a child through the fence and kill the child? That's the problem with the pit bull. I think that the bad breeding of this particular dog has led to a dog that becomes confused. And the fact that it was bred for aggression, bred for killing and for violence, it gets redirected onto the wrong people, and you have these incidents. So it's a terrible tragedy. But, you know, it's people that own the dogs. It's people that put the child with the dog. It's people that failed to put the muzzle on the dog when the dog was around the little child. We all know that pit bulls have killed young children. We all know that. That means we all should be more careful when we're around pit bulls and when we're letting them be in contact with small children.
Ken, it's time for us to go. I appreciate you joining us. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Take care. Todd, do you want a final comment on pit bulls and what we've talked about today? You have about 30 seconds.
Sure. I, you know, again, I think it comes down to owner responsibility. You know, again, if you have a dog, whether that's a pit bull or a chihuahua or anything, and you have a 2 or 3 year old child, don't leave them in a room together. Don't leave food out where the dog, if it's going to have food aggression, might bite that child. You know, don't chain your dog. It's going to be more, you know, have more prone to aggression and spay neuter. You know, that's not only going to cut down on the overpopulation crisis of animals we have in this country, but it's also going to reduce the animal's propensity to bite.
All right. Hey, Todd, it's been a pleasure. Thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you.
All right. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. I'll tell you about next week's show, which is almost going to be something like two pit bulls going at each other. We're going to talk about marijuana legalization. Be right back.